good morning, good afternoon, and good evening. Thank you for attending the Sustainability Summit. Over the last number of years, with the increasing global demand for corporate reporting and disclosure on sustainability, ESG, and climate-related information, the need for international, independent sustainability assurance standards that increase both confidence and trust in reported information became clear. The IAASB is now responding to this public interest challenge. Our objective is an ambitious one, to develop a global baseline standard for sustainability assurance that will work with any suitable sustainability reporting framework or standard. We are also committed to the goal that this standard will be available to all assurance practitioners from any profession who are committed to and meet relevant ethical and quality management requirements. With these goals in mind, last month, the IAASB issued Proposed International Standard on Sustainability Assurance 5000, General Requirements for Sustainability Assurance Engagement. The exposure draft addresses both limited and reasonable assurance engagements on information reported across any sustainability matter. The proposed standard benefits from close consultation with global organizations, including securities regulators through IOSCO, independent audit regulators at IFAC, the Financial Stability Board, and our partners at IASBA. We have also engaged with international standard setters for sustainability reporting and assurance, such as ISSB, GRI, ISO, and accountability. We know that the proposed standard is not yet a finished product. It is for this reason we have launched significant global outreach efforts, including today's summit. We want to hear your voice and engage with as wide a group of stakeholders as possible. Today's discussions are integral to achieving a high-quality, robust, and globally accepted standard. We also ask you to provide your formal feedback before December 1st using either our response template or stakeholder survey. Links to both are available on our website, IAASB.org/ISSA5000. Your feedback is crucial to a final standard that is comprehensive, supports consistent high-quality engagements, and will be adopted, implemented, and useful for sustainability reporting users. Next on the agenda are IAASB Vice Chair and Chair of our Sustainability Assurance Task Force, Josephine Jackson, along with additional IAASB members, are going to go into further detail on the proposed standard. Before I close, I'd like to thank IFAC and its partners, AFA, CAPA, SAFA, and the Jeju Group for holding this summit and including our proposed standard on the agenda. Your partnership and support are greatly appreciated. Thank you.
We will now kick off with the next session hosted by the IAASB. I'm just going to spotlight each of the
speakers. Thank you. And hello to everyone, and thank you so much for joining this segment of the webinar today. It is a real pleasure always to be here, and to echo Tom and in fact Johnny's comments as well, we really do hope that you will be an active participant in our ongoing consultation process. If we quickly move to the next slide, that would be wonderful. Thank you. So today we are going to take what we call a deeper dive into the very important topic of assurance and sustainability reporting. And in our time together, we will be talking through how proposed 5000 actually addresses the key elements of a sustainability assurance engagement. So before we deep dive into the standard though, Chun Wei is going to give us that overall introduction to the standard, how it came about, our thought process in building it, all the building blocks as it were. Then we'll be rolling up our sleeves a bit as Warren takes us through the key concepts, the key concepts, principles, and definitions. It's early for me, so I haven't quite finished my coffee yet, but I'll improve. And then Sachiko will continue our deep dive and talk about practitioner materiality and the approach to risk and response. And then Bill will cover some final important areas, which is misstatements, other information, and of course, communications and reporting. reporting. So that really, really critical transparency piece. So before we close, I will give you a flavour of the other outreach activity we have planned and have planned. And if you do have any feedback or questions, please post them in the Q&A box. We will be keeping a lookout for them during the discussion. And I have various points to pause and raise those with our panel here of speakers. We may not be able to address all the questions in the Q&A box today, but we will take them all away and have them in mind when finalising the standard or finalising the standard or building any educational materials such as FAQs. So if we can move on to the next slide, please, and let's get you all started and kick off with Chum Wee providing the overall introduction. Thank you, Chum Wee. Over to you.
Thank you very much, Josephine. And hello, everyone. I'm delighted to be kicking off the session with a short introduction. So both Tom and Johnny have in their welcome remarks explained why we are here to respond to the public interest need, which is to increase the confidence and trust in sustainability information that is increasingly being reported around the world. So what have we done to respond to that public interest need? And what have we done with ISSA 5000? Next slide, please. So 5000 represents, we think, a significant improvement over existing standards in terms of driving consistency and quality, because we have added a great deal of specificity, this is the word that I'll eventually get right, over existing assurance standards as it relates to sustainability information. Now, ED5000 provides the general requirements for sustainability assurance engagement. It is an overarching standard for sustainability. It covers the entire engagement from beginning to the end, from engagement acceptance all the way to reporting. Now, at the same time, recognizing that it is an overarching standard, we can't have everything all at once. So it is not going to provide the same level of details that we have now with financial audit, with the full suite of international standards on auditing. And we need to recognize also that reporting landscape, reporting practice, as well as sustainability practice are on a maturity curve. And we need flexibility to deal with emerging issues and other stakeholders' feedback moving forward. Now, having now opened up this new 5000 series, we have now the opportunity to go deeper in future standards. And we may next go into specific topics such as human rights, such as biodiversity. We could go into aspects of topics, performance against targets, strategy, or we could go into specific elements within an engagement, such as materiality reporting, internal controls. So we're keeping an open mind about what we may deal with in greater detail at a later date. And we will launch such project proposals in response to practitioners' needs and requests and evolving regulatory requirements or market practice. Next slide, please. So there are a few overall design principles that we thought will be helpful and important to flag to you up front. And I'll be making 6 points here on this slide. The first point is ED5000. It is designed to be suitable for use for all sustainability topics and information disclosed about these topics. So I've written the standard to be framework and topic neutral, so it can be applied on whichever framework a company adopts to report on sustainability. So it could be, for example, the European ESRS, it could be ISSB standard, the one that we spent a lot of time on in the first webinar just yesterday. Number two, one thing that we've heard repeatedly from regulators and other policymakers is that we need to make the standard profession agnostic. And what that means is that it has to be relevant to and it must be capable of being applied by both professional accountants and non-accountants practitioners, as long as they fulfill the requirements of the standard. And we will come back to a specific point on this a little bit later. Number three, we knew that it's important for ED5000 to be an entirely standalone standard. So you will not need to refer to ISA 3000 to understand the foundational principles for performance of an assurance engagement, because all the necessary elements have been brought over to ED 5000. We've also brought over aspects of 3410, our standard on assurance over greenhouse gas statement to 5000 as well, to the extent that they are appropriate for an overarching standard. And being a standalone standard also support to a certain extent the earlier point about the standard being profession agnostic. So a non-accountant practitioner who may not be as familiar with IAASB standard can just dive right into 5000. Four, the next point I'm going to share is actually particularly important. It is absolutely critical that all practitioners applying 5000, whether you are a professional accountant or not, that you are committed to adherence to stringent ethical requirements that are at least as demanding as the IASB code, which includes independence requirements, as we all know. And it's also critical that the practitioners are part of a practice, a firm that is subject to ISQM, the quality management standard, or something that is at least as demanding. So these are the fundamental premise to all IAASB standards, the non-negotiable elements, if you like, that underpin quality. Number five, ED 5000 addresses both limited and reasonable assurance. And where appropriate, we have signposted requirements and application materials that are different under limited versus reasonable assurance, with a capital L or R next to the numbers. And in the requirements itself, you can see that they are presented in tabular form. So they're in table format to facilitate ease of comparison. And hopefully that will aid with the understanding of the differentiation and work efforts. And I think this will come in particularly helpful when there's a need to transition from a limited assurance engagement in 1 year into a reasonable assurance engagement in the next. And we know that in some jurisdictions, this is already being mandated or proposed to be mandated. Six, and finally, we have developed ED 5000 to be principle-based while still providing sufficient specificity to drive consistency of the conduct of the sustainability assurance engagement and to help address challenges typically faced in conducting such engagement. And as you can imagine, it's often a delicate balance. We often have one CAM telling us to keep it at a high level, principle-based, don't end up with rigid rules. And then another CAM that will tell us, give us more illustration, give us more guidance, give us more support. So like many aspects of the proposed standard, we will be very keen to hear what you think, whether we have landed in the right place. So with that introduction, Josephine, let me hand it back to you. Thank you.
Thank you, Chenwei, for that introduction. It certainly does help the stage, of course, for our deeper dive. So if we can have the next slide, please. Thank you. So Warren, I'm going to turn it over to you now to discuss an area that the board spent quite a lot of time talking about, particularly those key principles and definitions, which of course are critically important to get pinned down before you embark on these engagements. So over to you. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Josephine. And I mean, as you all know, definitions is something very close to my heart. So I'm really delighted to be talking to everybody today about definitions and key terms. And I was also very excited to hear Chenwei sort of picking up on some of these words, you know, elements and topics and disclosures and aspects of topics. And I think when you hear all of this for the first time, it just adds to that alphabet soup that we all like to talk about. And you probably scratch your head and think, what exactly do all of these different terms and words mean? And how should they be applied in the context of sustainability assurance? So what we have on the next slide is a very brief outline of some of these terms and how they sort of fit into the broader alphabet soup. And we'll start working through this nice and systematically. So starting off in the middle, I suppose, with the green colored boxes, where we talk about sustainability information and the disclosures about the sustainability information. And just to provide a sort of overarching conceptual structure, some of our more technical members of the audience will probably remember that in any assurance engagement, we've got certain key ingredients or certain key concepts that need to be present or feature in the engagement. Talk about the parties involved in the engagement, suitability of criteria, the information that's being reported, the evidence that we're using, and our conclusion. And what I and the remainder of the speakers are going to be doing, sort of demonstrating to you how those core essential features of assurance are actually being addressed by ISSA 5000. And we'll sort of start off with the information that's actually being reported. That's sustainability information. Or for those of you, again, more technically minded, the subject matter information. Our sustainability information is made up really of the sum of all of the disclosures that you might find in the document that the assurance provider is actually working with. And it can be as broad or narrow as will be dictated by the facts and circumstances of the particular entity which is engaged in the reporting. So that sustainability information or subject matter information will be made up of these particular disclosures, and we can break those disclosures down further and start thinking about them as topics or aspects of topics. And these sit under the sustainability matters or the actual base subject matter. Those topics are where we see the E, the S, and the G starting to creep into ISSA 5000. We could have topics dealing with environmental issues. And so some examples here will be things like climate or biodiversity. We can have topics dealing with the social dimension, for example, labor practices. And we could also have topics dealing with certain governance issues. And those topics can be articulated or described by thinking about different aspects of those topics. So what are your risks and opportunities as they pertain to biodiversity or labor? What are the relevant governance metrics? What are the key performance indicators that you have on these particular topics? And please don't think that it's a one-to-one relationship. These topics and aspects of topics can map in a whole host of different ways, depending on, again, the underlying circumstances of the entity and the frameworks which are being used to prepare all of the sustainability information. So we're not dealing here with a major paradigm shift. We've got this core idea of we have subject matter or sustainability matters, and that gets converted into sustainability information or subject matter information, which really provides the base or the content of the document that houses all of this information being communicated to your user group. We'll talk in a bit more detail about how we get from the blue boxes to the green boxes. But before we do that, you might take a step back and think, gee, these guys have really managed to overcomplicate all of this. Why are we going into so much detail about topics and aspects of topics and disclosures and sustainability matters and sustainability information? But there is method in the madness. We need to remember that as we currently sit, we don't have a universal baseline. We don't have a single set of sustainability reporting standards that apply across the entire world. And these sustainability standards and how people are reporting on sustainability information varies significantly from jurisdiction to jurisdiction. In fact, the terminology that we use to describe these different documents housing all of this information also varies from jurisdiction to jurisdiction. So what we wanted to do was to provide a type of conceptual grounded point of reference. So that as you begin this engagement from the outset, we have a clear understanding of what it is we're actually trying to express an opinion on, using terminology that's universally applicable and tying into those points that Chunwi, Josephine, and Tom have raised. This need for a standard that is professionally neutral and standard neutral to make sure that it's operable in different contexts, different settings, different jurisdictions. So if we can move on to sort of the next part of this particular slide and unpack it in a little bit more detail, I promised that I would talk to you about how we transition from the blue box into the green box. How do we get from these sustainability matters into the sustainability information? Well, in the spirit of professional neutrality and technical neutrality, we like to think about there being suitable criteria. In Tom's presentation, he said that this standard is operable for any suitable sustainability reporting standard. So what do we actually mean by that? Well, what we mean is that we have a set of criteria, the sort of the building blocks that are going to be used, the instruction manual, if you like, for compiling the sustainability information. And that criteria can be made up of framework criteria. And again, you could have a whole host of different frameworks, one or more frameworks that have been produced by a standard setter forming those criteria. And you could have entity developed criteria, criteria building blocks, I suppose the equivalent of accounting policies that have been constructed by the organization, or you could have a combination of both. And all of that sort of makes up our criteria. Now, while we were working and developing the standard, we cheated a little bit and we started to think about some of the common criteria which are already in existence. We thought about some really long-standing criteria that deal with sustainability information, like, for example, the GRI. We thought about criteria that like to blend everything together, like, for example, integrated reporting and their framework. And we also thought about criteria that were coming out of jurisdictions where sustainability information reporting is to be mandated, like the European Union and their CSRD requirements. We thought about all of those as we were working with the development of the standard to make sure that, that we were actually operable, that this document could be applied in a practical setting. But when you read ISSA 5000, you're not going to find extensive references to these documents because, again, we wanted the standard to be framework neutral. We don't want people to think that it's only applicable to GRI reporting or integrated reporting or reporting under the CSRD requirements. It should be applicable to any suitable framework that's being used to compile our sustainability information. But it was useful to reflect on those standards as a type of pilot study, a sense check, as we were developing the standard and thinking about how it would work in different contexts or settings. So we've got all of those criteria, but management needs to come in and apply its professional judgment. It needs to think about how it's going to take those criteria and then the universe of sustainability matters, all the different topics that one could potentially report on in a sustainability context, and translate that into sustainability information. And I like to think of it personally as a type of filtering process. You've got all of these sustainability matters floating around. They sort of go through this particular filter, which is our criteria and management's judgment as they think about materiality. And what comes out is a distilled set of sustainability information that sort of percolates into to the integrated or sustainability or ESG reports. Now, that materiality determination process is going to bring up this famous issue of double materiality. How does management know if the information being reported to the stakeholder is useful? That's again going to depend on facts and circumstances. And unfortunately, there's more terminology now to add to our alphabet soup. In some cases, people want to talk about sustainability information and view it through a financial lens. How does the E, S, and G translate into an economic implication for the firm? And they might refer to financial materiality or direct materiality. Direct materiality may also capture the impact which the organization has on environmental, social, or governance considerations. Indirect materiality might also refer to this concept of environmental, social, and governance factors impacting or affecting the organization. You might also have heard of this concept of inside out or outside in, depending on how you want to look at it. So inside out, the organization has an impact on the ESG factors, and outside in, the ESG factors have an impact on the organization. To put it very simply, you might be focusing on a situation where you're looking at how does an ESG factor impact the entity, in which case you have a single materiality? Or you might be looking at a situation where you're not only worried about how ESG impacts the entity, you're also worried about how the entity impacts the ESG. And in that case, you have double materiality. Now, the materiality we're talking about at this point is from the preparer's perspective. How does the preparer decide if all of this information is useful to the user? And they will be guided by financial materiality constructs, this logic of direct or indirect, inside out and outside in materiality, largely being driven by those framework criteria that apply in the particular jurisdiction. ISSA 5000 accommodates both types of logics. It's not specific to one set of materialities or another. So whether or not an entity is using double materiality to construct its sustainability information is not a particular consideration for us in determining whether or not you have suitable criteria and whether or not the engagement could be conducted using ISSA 5000. So our criteria, to put it really simply, are effectively the way in which we would translate or filter subject matters into subject matter information, or sustainability matters into sustainability information. Different words for saying the same thing. And when we think about materiality determination, what we're thinking about is whether or not we have criteria that provide useful information to our users. Do we end up with information thanks to our criteria, which are relevant, complete, reliable, neutral, and understandable? That results in a whole set of disclosures, and those disclosures, again, in the little green box, could be characterized differently. They could be qualitative or quantitative, factual or historical, forward-looking, prospective, take on a whole host of different characteristics, providing useful information to our users and housed in different types of documents, sustainability reports, GRI reports, integrated reports, CSRD-based reports. That doesn't really matter. As Chunwei pointed out, this standard is sufficiently broad to be applied in a whole host of different settings. If we could just advance to the last part of the slide. So all of that is subject, of course, to the actual scope of the engagement and, of course, to the type of conclusion that one would necessarily have. So because of this diversity in terms of the sustainability reporting, the different types of disclosures that you might get, the different frameworks which are in play, the different materiality determination processes, it follows that you could have an assurance engagement that covers one or parts of, or more than one part of, that sustainability information. And this introduces a layer of complexity because we have sustainability information, some of which is assured by the practitioner, some of which is not assured by the practitioner. When Chunwei and I and the other speakers are talking about sustainability information, what we actually mean is sustainability information which has been assured or which is subject to assurance. And all of the other sustainability information in the traditional auditing lingo would be the other information that we need to think about as we sort of work through our engagement, but on which we do not necessarily provide an opinion. Now, those opinions could be a limited assurance opinion or a reasonable assurance opinion, or again, a combination of both, depending on the underlying facts and circumstances. And we might also find ourselves in a situation where perhaps even the entire sustainability report, in theory, is actually subject to some type of opinion. In reaching that opinion, particularly for a reasonable assurance engagement, we might have those assertions in the back of our mind. Those assertions are a well-established part of our auditing lingo, things like completeness, occurrence, existence, and so on. Those assertions help us to think about the representations that are being made by management or the entity when they prepare that sustainability report and help us think about how that sustainability information may be materially misstated. And then, of course, the implications for all of that on our actual assurance opinion. In a limited assurance engagement, one is not obligated to use these assurance, but also assertions, but also not precluded from using these assertions to help think about how the sustainability information may be materially misstated. Those assertions could be really helpful in trying to actually inform the conclusions that we're necessarily going to have on the assurance engagement or on the assurance opinion. So that slide gives us a really broad sense of all of the key topics, principles that you're going to be hearing about over the rest of the presentation. I've, of course, only covered two of those aspects of the fundamental parts of the assurance engagement, the criteria and the information to be reported. And I'm going to leave it to the other speakers to address the remaining parts of the assurance engagements. But before I hand over, I just want to share one last bit of information with you on the next slide, which deals with the different people that are actually involved in executing these particular engagements. And there's this really great table that summarizes some very technical parts of ISSA 5000 particularly well. So to put it nice and simply, we have the engagement team, the firm personnel who are performing the assurance engagement. They're the starting point of the process and they're the first row in the table. And we've got the engagement leader, and the core principle is that our engagement leader is the responsible for ethics, for quality management, for direction, supervision, and review, and ultimately for reaching those conclusions we spoke about on the previous slide. So our engagement leader needs to be sufficiently and appropriately involved in the work being performed by the team, which is why you'll see in the second column where we are unable to be sufficiently involved, we've put not applicable in that particular box. Now, the team might not operate in isolation because we are dealing with very complex subject matter information, a whole host of different types of disclosures. We might need to bring in different individuals that have expertise in different areas of sustainability reporting and accounting. And these might come in the form of what we're referring to here as internal experts or external experts. Now, if you think about it, an internal expert is really just part of your engagement team. So that, again, falls under this concept of adequate involvement in the work being performed. But we might also bring in an external expert to assist us, somebody that's not necessarily part of our team, but is necessarily involved in helping us to compile the work, or rather perform the work which is being performed, and reach a conclusion on that sustainability information. Also bearing in mind that the sustainability report might not cover just that legal entity. It might include one or more entities from a legal point of view, or different structures or business units that might not necessarily be legally incorporated, but are separate from the main entity on some type of technical or operational level. Or it could include different entities or bodies in the whole host of the value chain. So it's conceivable that we might need to use other practitioners, some of those practitioners being part of our firm or network firm, some of those practitioners not being part of our firm or network firm. Again, it all falls under this general principle of wanting to be sufficiently and appropriately involved in their work in order to be able to drive a work effort that allows us to express an opinion on that sustainability information. There are, however, some cases where we might not be able to be sufficiently and appropriately involved in the work being performed by another practitioner. ISSA 5000 takes that practical or takes those practicalities into consideration. It provides some details. Those of you that are interested in reading further can have a look at paragraphs 42 to 51 and 54, where the standard goes into a little bit more detail on how we would gain comfort that we can actually place reliance on that practitioner's work, even though we were unable to be sufficiently and appropriately involved in that individual's work effort. So that's probably more than enough from me. And so I'm going to hand over now to Josephine, who'll coordinate the rest of the presentation for us. Thanks very much.
And thank you, Warren, so much. And I personally really like the way those first three slides pull all the pieces together of this actually quite complex jigsaw of key concepts and terms in a very nice, simplified manner. And you did that as well, very well. Thank you. And I would encourage our participants to use those slides, perhaps when deep diving into the standard, along with that chart on the individuals involved in the engagement, which is actually a really good summary. I just had a couple of things pop up and just wanted to take a pause and ask some questions. And maybe first to Chumwi. Chumwi, you mentioned that 3410 was actually used in developing 5000. But another question that crops up is our use of the EER guidance. I mean, we did look at the EER guidance, didn't we, in developing the exposure draft. But perhaps you could comment on a question which crops up quite often, which is what's the future of EER guidance? Is it to be mothballed or is it to be updated? And to you, thank you.
Thanks, Josephine. Well, it's everyone beloved EER guidance. So I don't think anyone wants to see being mothballed. But you know, just in terms of what the task force has done to bring elements of EER into ISSA 5000, I think that has been excellent. I really like that. But of course, you know, the standard is an overarching standard, it's principle-based. It wouldn't have as much detail as you will get in the EER guidance. So EER guidance, by all means, very helpful in practice and can continue to be referred to by practitioners. It's more detailed. But as with all our activities, whether there's a need to update EER guidance, it will be considered as part of our overall due process, which include public consultations on the strategy and work plan. So hopefully when we get to that stage, everyone will come in and vote for EER to be updated. Thanks, Josephine.
That's great. Thank you so much, Chumwi. Warren, in a financial statement audit, there is, of course, a conclusion on the financial statements of the whole, as a whole, which is obviously very critical. And it appears that as a whole concept is in your slides, but how one of the questions came up is how, as you have indicated, does the scope of the subject matter subject to the engagement work with this? You know, it will vary. How will as a whole work? Does it actually not work at all? Is that the case?
That's a very good question. And as you point out, it's a term that's come through from financial reporting. And if you must think about it, I mean, this concept of fair presentation on the information as a whole sort of took a good 200 years of technical development before we got there. So when it comes to sustainability information and people ask this question, I suppose you always should say, be patient, because I think eventually as a whole is something we will become accustomed to and we will start to see. It's something that came up in Tom's presentation to an extent of wanting the standard to be future-proof. So yes, I think as a whole is something that we could see coming through, even though it's not necessarily something we're seeing at the moment. The reason we're not seeing it at the moment goes back to that diagram that we were having a look at. There are a lot of different types of sustainability information with different characteristics, different disclosures, huge variability in practice in what we are seeing people reporting on. So there's not a universally agreed definition of what as a whole means. We're not necessarily seeing opinions on as a whole at the moment, but that doesn't mean that we won't be seeing that in the future as this becomes more entrenched and we all get used to this concept of assuring sustainability information. Those overarching principles, though, will continue to apply. You've got your criteria that guide the sustainability information. You've got that materiality determination process. You've got that professional judgment, both at the level of management and at the level of the practitioner. And it's a question of being able to collect that sufficient appropriate evidence, which Bill and others will discuss, in order to reach a conclusion. And in some cases, if need be, to issue some type of modified conclusion if, as a whole, we're actually not comfortable that we've achieved some type of fair presentation.
Yeah, I agree with that. That's great. Thank you. Okay, so Adrian, if you could move to the next slide. Thank you. And by the way, Warren, you've got lots of claps and hearts during a presentation, which we thought was, that's a first on our webinar. So thumbs up to you for that one. Sachiko, we're going to move to the topics of practitioner materiality, risk and response, which of course are equally critical elements of an assurance engagement. So there's some lovely more hearts, great. So Sachiko, over to you.
Thank you, Josephine, and hello, everyone. I'm Sachiko Kai. It's great to follow our board member, Chun Wei and Warren, because they set the scene greatly. So I just would like to present you a little bit deep dive on exposure draft, which is materiality and risk and response section of exposure draft. So firstly, I'd like to touch on materiality in planning and performing the engagement. In exposure draft, materiality refers to threshold of significance to user decision making considered by the practitioner in relation to potential and identified misstatement in the circumstances of the engagement. And we heard from the outreach that the concept of materiality in sustainability reporting is very challenging, but also very important to stakeholders, including the entities and the practitioners. And challenges arise from the fact that, unlike financial statements, which are reported in single currency unit, sustainability information may be measured in different units. As mentioned in Warren's example, it's very obvious. For example, sustainability report could include, among other things, carbon dioxide emission measured in tons and safety violation measured in number of instances. And also sustainability information also includes qualitative disclosures, for example, description of processes. And the different measurement unit makes it difficult to determine materiality for the sustainability information as a whole. And also it is more challenging to determine materiality when planning and performing an engagement for qualitative disclosure, because it is difficult to assign a number to qualitative disclosures. But we heard an outreach that the practitioner actually do apply the concept of materiality to the evaluation of misstatements identified in qualitative disclosures. Therefore, in the exposure draft, we take a bifurcated approach between quantitative disclosures versus qualitative disclosures. As you can see in the slide, in planning and performing the engagement, for quantitative disclosures, exposure draft would require the practitioner to determine materiality and also performance materiality to deal with aggregation risk, which is consistent with ISAE 3410. For qualitative disclosure, exposure draft would require the practitioner to consider materiality. So next slide, please. Thank you. Now let's focus on risk and understanding. First, the practitioner must obtain understanding of the entity and its environment, the applicable criteria, and the system of internal control. And the question is there a difference in understanding required between reasonable and limited assurance engagements? The answer is, of course, yes. The difference in work effort between limited and reasonable assurance is one of the key things that we address in the exposure draft. The proposed standard differentiates the purpose of the understanding. In other words, what are the risks you need to consider, which drives the difference in work effort? In the slide, you can see the lady holding you, which means understanding, lens. And there is a balance. R means reasonable assurance and L means limited assurance. So what is the purposeful understanding? In a limited assurance engagement, purposeful understanding is to identify disclosures in the sustainability information where material misstatements are likely to arise and design procedure to focus on those disclosures. So in a limited assurance engagement, the practitioner focuses procedures on the riskier disclosures at the disclosure level. In the reasonable assurance engagement, the purpose of the understanding is to identify and assess the risks of material misstatement at the assertion level for the disclosures and design further procedures. Assertion includes completeness or occurrence of the disclosure, et cetera. There are more examples included in the proposed standard. So in the reasonable assurance engagement, there is a more granular focus on the risk of material misstatement. That is why in the slide, R side is heavier than L side. Next slide, please. So the different purpose drive the differentiation of the work effort between limited and reasonable assurance engagement related to the required understanding of the entity's system of internal control. So what the practitioner is required to understand with respect to the entity's control environment and entity's information system relevant to the sustainability information, the board believe it is important to understand them in both reasonable and limited assurance engagement. With respect to the entity risk assessment and the monitoring processes for limited assurance engagement, the board believes that understanding those processes may go beyond what is appropriate. So understanding those processes is not required for limited assurance engagement, but understanding the results of the entity's risk assessment process is required because it will be helpful to the practitioner in identifying disclosures where material misstatements are likely to arise in a limited assurance engagement. With respect to control activities component, in a reasonable assurance engagement, the practitioner is required to understand the control activity component. Understanding the control activities component includes understanding those controls that the practitioner intend to test operating effectiveness and any related general IT controls, and any other controls that the practitioner judges necessary to identify risks or design further procedures. In both limited assurance and reasonable assurance engagement, if the practitioner plans to test the operating effectiveness control to obtain evidence, the practitioner is required to understand that control and any related general IT controls. And understanding control means evaluating the design of the control and determining whether it has been implemented. When speaking of extent of the understanding of the components of internal control, for limited assurance engagement, the focus of the understanding is more limited than reasonable assurance engagement. In a reasonable assurance engagement, the exposure draft includes requirements to understand and evaluate each of the components. On the other hand, in a limited assurance engagement, the practitioner is required to understand components, but not required to evaluate each of those components, except for the information system. Information system is very important, and therefore evaluation applies to both reasonable and limited assurance engagement. Next slide, please. So now I would like to focus on risk responses. Again, this is driven by the purposes. In a limited assurance engagement, the practitioner designs and performs procedures that are focused on those disclosures in the sustainability information where material misstatements are likely to arise. In a reasonable assurance engagement, the practitioner designs and performs procedures that are responsive to the risks of material misstatement at the assertion level for the disclosures. In the toolkit, the practitioner has testable controls, which the practitioner would only do if they have obtained an understanding of those controls and plan to obtain evidence about operating effectiveness of those controls, and substantive procedures, such as testable details and analytical procedures. However, sometimes the practitioner may identify conditions that indicate that misstatements may occur pervasively throughout the sustainability information. This condition may include such as deficient control environment, or identify the suspected fraud or non-compliant with law regulation, or a situation where the practitioner has identified material misstatement throughout the sustainability information. In these cases, the practitioner performs overall responses, which may include things like closer direction, supervision or review of staff, or calling more experienced staff, more procedure conducted at the period end rather than the interim date, or adding an element of unpredictability in testing, or increasing the extent of procedures. Next slide, please. So I'd like to touch on additional procedures in a limited assurance engagement. The objective of a limited assurance engagement is to report whether a matter has come to the practitioner's attention to cause the practitioner to believe that the sustainability information is not prepared or not fairly presented in all material respects in accordance with applicable criteria. In focusing procedure on disclosure in the sustainability information where material misstatements are likely to arise, the practitioner may identify matters that cause them to believe there may be a misstatement. When this happens, the practitioner performs additional procedures, which we have been calling the deep dive. That is why there is an image of a diver on the slide. The practitioner performs additional procedure on those procedures until they have concluded that the information is not likely to be misstated or determined that there is a material misstatement. If the practitioner is unable to conclude either way, then a scope limitation exists and the practitioner cannot form an unmodified conclusion. Next slide, please. Now, I'd like to talk about the specific area. Firstly, estimate and forward-looking information. We heard on the outreach that estimate and forward-looking information are common in sustainability information and therefore guidance is needed. Forward-looking information may include forecasts, projections, and information about future risks and opportunities, for example, disclosures associated with the transition to net zero. Both forward-looking information and estimate have a degree of uncertainty and judgment. When developing estimate and forward-looking information, regardless of the source of degree of uncertainty or extent of judgment involvement, it is necessary for management to appropriately apply the applicable criteria and select and use appropriate methods, assumptions, and data. Therefore, the IAASB concluded that the most appropriate approach was to address estimate and forward-looking information together in the responding to risk of material misstatement section of the exposure draft. In developing relevant requirement and related application material, we consider the requirement in application material in ISSA 540 revised, which addresses accounting estimates. The proposed standard differentiates between the work effort required in limited versus reasonable assurance engagement. In a limited assurance engagement, the practitioner evaluates management application of the criteria, the method for developing estimates or forward-looking information, and appropriateness change from the prior period. The practitioner then considers whether other procedures are necessary. In a reasonable assurance engagement, the practitioner may test how management developed the estimates or forward-looking information, including evaluating the method, assumption, and data, develop point estimate or range to evaluate the management disclosures, or obtain evidence from events occurring up to the date of the practitioner's report. Although it is not mentioned in the slide, I'd also like to talk about analytical procedure a little bit. The standard also contemplates the use of analytical procedures. When performing analytical procedures, the practitioner is required to develop an expectation about recorded quantities or ratios. But the expectation is expected to be more precise in a reasonable assurance engagement than a limited assurance engagement. Next slide, please. Finally, I'd like to talk about fraud and professional skepticism. We heard a lot of views from stakeholders that appropriate consideration to the topic of fraud, including greenwashing, of course, and professional skepticism is very, very important. Therefore, The exposure draft includes requirements relating to fraud and professional skepticism throughout the engagement. For example, maintaining professional skepticism throughout the engagement, designing performance procedures in an unbiased manner to meet the purpose of the procedures, resolving any doubts about the relevance and the reliability of information to be used as evidence, responding appropriately to fraud or suspected fraud, considering whether identified misstatements may be due to fraud, or responding to managing bias, which, if intentional, is fraudulent. That's all for my presentation. Now I will hand back to Josephine.
Thank you so much, Sachiko. Sorry about that. I couldn't find my mute button. And that's been really helpful in highlighting some of the challenges that the board had as well in addressing these concepts, as I actually mentioned before, particularly materiality. It's not a financial statement audit, obviously, and it's not one giant overall materiality. It's just not going to work with sustainability assurance. But maybe to Warren's point, you know, sometimes it takes 200 years for these things to eventually come together. Let's hope that it takes less than 200 years for the materiality to sink in. So one thing that's cropped up in this Q&A and in our other webinars is actually slightly in relation to Chumwee's earlier comment about making sure the proposed standard took into account the recent thinking of the board. Now, ISO 315, as you know, is one of my favourites, of course, when it was revised, though we explicitly distinguished between the concepts of inherent risk and control risk. And maybe you could just talk a little bit about why we decided not to do that when we were developing 5000.
Yes, the separate assessment of inherent risk and control risk was introduced in ISSA 315 revised in 2019, and which became effective from the period beginning on after December 15, 2021. So it is a relatively new requirement, even in the world of the audit of the financial statements. And looking at the world of sustainability assurance in ISSA 5000, as this is a global baseline, we recognize that it was important to focus on the more challenging aspects. And then if there is a need to develop further requirements and application material for certain aspects of the engagement, this could be done at a later point in time. It is part of our journey. So we do not include the concept of a separate assessment of inherent risk and control risk, as we think it is premature to be included in ISSA 5000, which is an overarching standard. However, those familiar with auditing standards could determine that they prefer that approach in ISSA 315, and the ISSA 5000 actually does not prohibit this. But for a baseline standard, again, we felt this was disproportionate to mandate and wanted to focus on the implicit approach.
Thank you, Sachiko. Chumwee, one of the questions that's cropped up, which is probably really both you and Sachiko, but perhaps you could give it a shot, is whether our standard allows for a combination of a limited assurance engagement on one particular area and a reasonable assurance engagement on another. So, for example, in that sustainability report, could you have two different conclusions?
And the answer is yes. And I believe we have illustration, if I remember correctly, correct me if I'm wrong, Josephine, we have illustration in the ED as well on that.
That's great. Thank you, Chumwee. Okay, so we are going to move on to the next slide, please. And we're going to move ahead and bring some of that materiality that Sachiko was talking to life for a little bit here in respect of misstatements, other information, communication and reporting. And for these topics, Bill, I'm going to hand over to you. Thank you.
Thanks, Josephine. We have the next slide, please. You can see I'm going to talk now about material misstatements in both sustainability information and other information. Now, misstatements can arise from error or fraud and may be qualitative or quantitative, and that includes omitted information. there are many examples in the application material of misstatements to be to help you out there. As we've said with other parts of the standard, the ED rather, we did look to ISAE 3000, ISAE 3410, and the EER guidance as a starting point for this standard. In this particular section, we also looked at ISO 450, evaluation of misstatements identified during the audit. The board has prepared application material to explain two key challenges in this particular area. Firstly, in accumulating and evaluating misstatements for qualitative disclosures, and secondly, in aggregating misstatements when they relate to aspects of topics or topics that are of a dissimilar nature and therefore not comparable. Let me look at the level at which misstatements should be evaluated, and that's the left-hand side of the slide. We look at it for each disclosure, and we look at it for the disclosures in aggregate. For each disclosure, this, for example, in performing procedures on the disclosure of work-related injuries, the practitioner identifies more than one misstatement. The practitioner determines whether the disclosure of work-related injuries is materially misstated by evaluating the individual and combined effect of the identified misstatements on that disclosure. For the disclosures in aggregate, for example, here the practitioner is providing a conclusion in the assurance report on whether the sustainability information related to occupational health and safety is prepared in all material respects in accordance with the applicable criteria. Accordingly, the practitioner determines whether all of the misstatements related to the topic of occupational health and safety, including the misstatements identified regarding work-related injuries, are material. To the right-hand side of the slide, the misstatement of other information. Now, the practitioner reads and considers other information for material inconsistencies or material misstatements. Other information is information included in a document or documents containing the sustainability information subject to the insurance engagement. Sustainability information may be presented together with the entity's audited financial statements. For example, as part of the entity's annual report, or in a separate document or documents accompanying the annual report. In these circumstances, the audited financial statements are considered other information for the purposes of this ED. The board did not consider it appropriate for the practitioner to be required to obtain and consider other information not available until after the date of the assurance report, as required in ISO 720 for listed entities. A misstatement of the other information exists when the other information is incorrectly stated or otherwise misleading, including because it omits or obscures information necessary for a proper understanding of a matter disclosed in the other information. Go ahead to the next slide, please. Now I'll talk about communicating with those charged with governance and reporting. Let me start with communicating with those charged with governance. Paragraph 62 of the ED requires a practitioner to determine whether, pursuant to the terms of the engagement and other engagement circumstances, any significant matters have come to the attention of the practitioner to be communicated with management, those charged with governance, or others. The application material provides examples of significant matters that may be appropriate to communicate. Some are provided in the slide. For example, identified or suspected fraud or non-compliance with laws and regulations, identified deficiencies in internal control, management bias in the preparation of the sustainability information, or uncorrected material misstatements. The board did discuss whether we should address communications with those charged with governance in greater detail. However, we decided that we should remain principles-based, given the evolving nature of sustainability assurance engagements and the different topics or aspects of topics that may be disclosed by the entity. However, the board is interested in views of respondents regarding communication with those charged with governance, including examples of types of matters you might like to see communicated. Looking at the assurance reporting side, overall, the board's development of assurance reporting was based, again, as I say, on the requirements of ISAE 3000 and ISAE 3410. But consideration was also given to the latest thinking which reflected in the ISAs, for example, ISA 700, 701, 705, and 706. The board's recently completed auditor reporting post-implementation review indicated a demand from stakeholders to consider changes to assurance reports for other engagements to align with the auditor's report on audited financial statements. Similarly, members of the board's reference groups noted there's a heightened need for communication by the assurance practitioner in the assurance report to meet the information needs of the intended users in a reporting environment that is evolving and maturing, and indeed reinforcing the consideration of long-form reporting. We do have a number of examples, as Chun Wei mentioned earlier, in the ED for, we have an example for reasonable assurance, we have an example for limited assurance, we have an example for our report on reasonable assurance on some disclosures and limited assurance on other disclosures. So you were right, Chun Wei. And we also have a modified opinion. So that there are those examples are there for you. The last point I'd like to mention, well, sorry, I should actually say by looking at the slide on the right-hand side there, some differences from, some innovations are practitioners' opinion to be included first, the name of the engagement leader to be included for listed entities, and to have a separate section on the other information. The last point I'd like to talk about is key audit matters. The board did acknowledge that the potential public interest benefits of communicating key audit matters and consider the outcome of the audit reporting post-implementation review that explored demand for extending the concept of CAM to other assurance reports. However, respondents to the post-implementation review were not supportive of communicating CAMs and other assurance reports. Concerns expressed included that users may perceive a greater level of assurance than is intended to be reported if a CAM is included in a limited assurance report. Costs may outweigh benefits to report CAM for assurance engagements, and a need to maintain a clear distinction between other types of assurance engagements and audits of financial statements. The board did note also the CAMs currently are mandatory only for audit reports on general purpose financial reports for listed entities under the ISSAs. I'll hand back to you, Josephine.
Thanks, Bill. Really appreciate the summary of those really, really very important and exciting themes. A couple of highlights for our participants is re-emphasise that in respect of material misstatements, as Bill says, the IAASB have recognised that this is complex and have included quite a bit of application material and exposure draft to help with this process. But to Chunwee's point right at the beginning, you know, feedback on whether we've got the balance right there is really helpful. You know, what's the difference between this is educational and, you know, this is critical in helping us achieve the outcome of the requirements. I also want to reiterate the point you made, Bill, that we were in a really fortunate position in developing the reporting section, having had that feedback from the post-implementation review, particularly that assurance standards needed to step up in terms of content and layout of the reports. And so it's really, really good evidence in developing our standard in that particular area. Bill, on examples, we had some questions on whether we would actually do more illustrations. You mentioned the four, but it was suggested that they're not very detailed. Would you like to explain the IAASB thoughts in terms of illustrative reports? What's our thinking there going forward?
Look, we're looking throughout the due process as this ED is exposed to get comments from respondents. We do have other illustrative reports in the EER guidance, which will bring it to life as well. But I ask if others have a need to let us know. We'll consider that with considering each of the other responses we get. But I would point out if you can be as precise as possible so that it helps us allocate our time as effectively as possible to any illustrations or implementation material that might be required.
Thank you. Okay. It'd be really, as you say, it'd be really interesting to get the feedback on our approach in those comment letters, which actually then takes me on to our final slides. So, Adrian, thank you. If you wouldn't mind moving on and perhaps to the next one. Lovely. So the consultation was released beginning of August. And as Johnny said right at the beginning, the closing date for responses to the exposure draft is 1st of December. In fact, Tom also said that. So now you heard it three times. So please do send in your feedback to the questions in the explanatory memorandum. We also launched a stakeholder survey aimed at our stakeholders who may not ordinarily respond to IAASB consultations, including preparers of sustainability information, or those with oversight, investors, and other users of sustainability information. However, as you can see here, there are lots of opportunities to learn more and participate in outreach. So including a roundtable we held in New York last week, we have three other global roundtables being held in Brussels, Kuala Lumpur, and Palo, as well as four regional roundtables events in Australia, Japan, Africa, and Canada. And a number of you have asked at the beginning about having access of copies to the slides. In fact, they will be available to you, of course. So all I have left to do now, actually, Adrian, is to thank our participants again for their attendance today, and to thank our wonderful panelists for providing insights and taking us through some of those deeper concepts within a standard. I would also like to take the opportunity to thank our hosts, IFAC, ASEAN Federation, CAPA, SAFA, and Jeju. And I look forward to hearing and reading your comments at the beginning of December. So, Adrian, that's a goodbye from us, and over to you.